And if I sing alone, it may prepare us for the time of trouble. I'm not sure, but but Dorothy, we're going to have to do it alone. So Dorothy is not exactly familiar with this tune, and so we're going to probably fumble our way through a little bit. But and then maybe you could even sing with me, and we all sing it, and then every day, if we sing together, by the end of the camp, I think we should memorize it. It's a verse. It's a little song from the book Mount of Blessings 101, page 101 of Mount of Blessings. And before we sing, we can just maybe look at it for a moment. And you know, it's one thing to come to camp meeting for 5 days out of the year, but it's another thing in our daily life to the other 360 days of the year. So here it says, if you will seek the Lord and be converted every camp meeting,
day.
Every day. If you will of your own spiritual choice, remember the Bible says, choose you this day whom you will serve. We're not automatons or robots. God doesn't force us or compel us. Neither can the devil compel us to sin. We all have a choice. Be free, if with your own spiritual choice, be free and joyous in God. If with gladsome consent of heart to his gracious call you come. What is the gracious call? Come unto me, all you that labor, and I will give you rest. Wearing the yoke of Christ, what did he say? My yoke is difficult. My burden is heavy. Wearing the yoke of Christ, the yoke of obedience, to whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, to him whose servants you are. The yoke of obedience and service. Okay, then what's going to happen? All of your murmurings will be what?
Still.
Do any of you ever have murmuring sometime?
Sure.
The children of Israel murmuring in the wilderness, murmuring in their tents. Okay, all your murmurings will be stilled. All your difficulties will be removed. All of us have difficulties, but it says they'll all be removed. All the perplexing problems that now confront you will be solved. All of us at times now and then have perplexing problems, difficulties, murmurings, but this is a wonderful promise. I think it's from the section on Mount of Blessings where it's describing about take no thought for the morrow, because the morrow will take thought for itself. But okay, Dorothy, and I'll sort of sing, and you can catch in, and it's sort of a new melody maybe, but it's a nice song, and there's something about singing that makes it so that it's easy to memorize. Probably you remember little songs you learned when you were a child, and you forget everything else, but these little songs are powerful. So let's... Seek the Lord and be converted every day. If you know, sing along. If you will of your own spiritual choice, be free and joyous in God. If with gladsome consent of heart to his gracious call you come. Wearing the yoke of Christ, the yoke of obedience and service, all your murmurings will be stilled. All your difficulties will be removed. All the perplexing problems that now confront you will be solved. Mount of Blessing 101. Sort of learned that? Okay, let's do one more time. Okay. If you will seek the Lord and be converted every day, if you will of your own spiritual choice be free and joyous in God, if with gladsome consent of heart to his gracious call you come, wearing the yoke of Christ, the yoke of obedience and service. All your murmurings will be stilled. All your difficulties will be removed. All the perplexing problems that now confront you will be solved. Mount of Blessings 101. Okay, I hope to be singing this song every day, and then it'll be getting pounded deeper and deeper into your subconscious mind, and then by camp time should be memorized. In Jesus, one of Jesus' last prayers, how did he pray? Do you remember? I in them, and what?
Them.
Thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one. And out of all the books in the Bible, the 66 books, these two books of Daniel and Revelation are special books. And it says here, when the books of Daniel and Revelation are better understood, believers will have what? An entirely different religious experience. Would you like to have that?
Amen.
That sounds like the Song of Moses and the Song of the Lamb. And they will be given such glimpses of the open gates of heaven that heart and mind will be impressed with the character. Now, at our camp this year, we're talking about character perfection, the character that all must develop in order to realize the blessedness which is to be the reward of the pure in heart. Now, Daniel is a wonderful example for us. And Daniel, in the book of Daniel, we don't learn so much about the who and the when and the where. But in the book of Daniel, we learn about what most people are mostly interested in, and that is the how. Let's just think for a moment about these six questions. Who? Who is the ones that need to develop a righteous character?
We do.
Yeah. Remember it says in the Bible, when the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, then were we like men that dreamed. Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue was singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord has done great things for them, and the Lord has done great things for us, whereof we are glad. So we are the ones that need to develop the character without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. And when? Now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation. Before the close of probation, when the fiat goes forth, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that is filthy, let him be filthy still. So it seems to me that it would behoove us now to be studying what it is to be righteous, what it is to be holy, because Amen. After that fiat goes forth, there'll be no changes. Okay, and where? Here on this earth before we get translated to heaven. But through Daniel, we can see some of the secrets of how Daniel perfected a character. And in Daniel 1, we have the whole account of the test of they were going to feed him with what? With all the dainties of the king's wine and dainties and all that. But Daniel, he purposed in his heart that what? With a portion of the king's meat. And he said, prove me for 10 days. Daniel was into experimental religion. Notice this. Oh, now I flubbed up here. How do I get this back on? I pushed the wrong button. Any tech?
One of the top two buttons. I think one on the right.
I was supposed to point
toward your computer too. That's where the let me see the button.
Okay.
What do you want to do?
I want to just get it back so this it doesn't have all this paraphernalia on the side, and then
the full screen. Yeah, I understand, but.
Okay, yeah, and now I got to press the bottom ones. Okay, got that. Thank you. Now, notice this interesting quote from the book. I think it's Amazing Grace. It says, how shall we know for ourselves God's goodness and love? We know that the goodness of God leads us to repentance, And we know that, the Bible says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of our life. And God's love, the depth and breadth and length and height of it. But how shall we know it? The psalmist tells us not. Sometimes in the testimony of Jesus, there's real interesting ways that she words things. But it says, the psalmist tells us not hear and know, or read and know, or believe and know, but taste and see that the Lord is good. Instead of relying upon the word of another, taste for yourself. Taste for yourself. And then experience is knowledge derived from experiment. Experimental religion is what is needed now. Taste and see that the Lord is good. So Daniel did an experiment for 10 days. And after 10 days, he was fair and fatter in flesh than all of the soothsayers and astrologers, the other people there. And then it says, after 3 years, what did it say about Daniel? 10 times better. And he understood the dreams and visions and had more wisdom 10 times, not 5 times or 7 times, but 10 times better. So it says experimental religion is what is needed now. Now, in my talks for a few moments, I'd like to talk a little bit about health in the beginning, because Daniel 1, it says when we understand the books of Daniel, we'll have an entirely different religious experience. And in Daniel 1, it was had to do with health, you know. And so it says, our first duty toward God and our fellow beings is that of self-development. Every faculty which the Creator has endowed us should be cultivated to the lowest degree of perfection. Is that what it says? The highest degree of perfection, that we may be able to do the least amount of good, the greatest amount of good of which we are capable. Hence, what does hence mean?
Therefore.
Therefore, that time, now the Bible says redeem the time. We don't have any time to waste. All of us from the President Obama down to the lowest bum on Skid Row sleeping in a park bench somewhere in Manhattan or whatever, all of us have 24 hours of time. And we can learn how to, you know, like the saying says, kill two birds with one stone, use our time in a wise way. But it says here that the time is spent to good account, which is used in the establishment and preservation of physical and mental health. We cannot afford to dwarf or cripple any function of body or mind. As surely as we do this, we must suffer the consequences. What does the Bible say? As a man soweth? Yeah. So, goes on here to say that God desires us to reach the standard of perfection made possible for us by the gift of Christ. God spared not his own son, but what did he do? Up for us all. And how shall he not with him freely give us all things? Ask and it shall be given you, he said. Seek and you shall find. God will help us. He calls upon us to make our choice on the right side, to connect with heavenly agencies, to adopt principles that will restore in us the divine image. It is in his written word and in the great book of nature. Ron will maybe be sharing about that. He has revealed the principles of life. It is our work to obtain a knowledge of these principles and by obedience to cooperate with him in restoring health to the body as well as the soul. And so Daniel there in Babylon, when he was confronted, now this thing turned red. What does that mean? Okay. He was confronted with a temptation and now next year and the next year, there's going to be candidates for the new presidency, right? They're already starting to come up. And when a new presidential election comes along, it starts out in the beginning, maybe there may be 7 or 8 candidates. And then it'll dwindle down just to the 2. And then finally, they choose one of the 2. But here it says that we are candidates for eternal life. For eternal life. All who are partakers of the divine nature will escape the corruption that is in the world through lust. It is impossible for those who indulge the appetite to attain to Christian perfection. Now, this comes close to all of us, every one of us here. So, in other words, Jesus fasting 40 days was not his hobby. Some people have hobbies of climbing mountains or collecting stamps or whatever, but Jesus' hobby wasn't to fast 40 days. There was a special reason that he fasted 40 days. I remember one time out in Korea, I saw a dog that was it was malnourished or it had some disease or something, and it was so skinny, this dog, that his ribs were showing, and the bones, all the shoulder bones or leg bones, all the specific bones that a dog has were just so visible, and his rib bones. And somehow, just when I saw that dog, I was with Bruce Hammer. Dave knows Bruce. I think it was maybe even his dog. But when I saw that dog, somehow my mind riveted to what Christ must have looked like after fasting 40 days. And it just brought tears to my eyes. I think even somewhere I read or heard something like, he was so emaciated. And there's some verse, how does it go in Isaiah there, that his visage was marred more than the sons of men, yes. So that even maybe his mother or disciples couldn't even recognize him. And that shows us the power of appetite. And here it says it's impossible. I just wondered what the word impossible meant. I know what it meant, but I wanted to just see what Noah's dictionary said about it. And I looked it up, and this is what Noah's dictionary says. It says, it is impossible that two and two should make five, or that a circle and a square make five, or that a circle and a square should be the same thing, or that a thing should be and not be at the same time. That was what Noah's dictionary said about it. But let's look in our Bibles here. You brought your Bibles this morning, Matthew 19, and about it, impossible. We know that the Bible says without faith it's impossible to please God. But let's see what Matthew 19 and verse 26. Matthew 19, verse 26. It says, but Jesus beheld them. Well, let's back up let's back up a couple of verses. Let's go all the way back to 23. Then Jesus said to his disciples, verily I say unto you, that a rich man shall hardly enter into the kingdom of heaven. Now, how many of you are rich? That's sort of a...
What's that?
Yeah, okay. You know, the Bible says, I know your poverty, one of the seven churches, but you are rich. And if someone asks you, are you rich? That's sort of a relative question, isn't it? Compared to some oil tycoon from Saudi Arabia, we're all very, very poor. But compared to somebody else in the world today, all of us are very rich. And so whatever we come as the final definition of who the rich are, anyway, verse 24 goes on and says, and again I say unto you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Now you remember Laodicea, they say we are rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. But they don't realize that they're wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. And so it goes on in verse 25 and says, when his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed, saying, who then can be saved? But Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. So sometimes people that may be struggling with appetite may think that it's impossible for me to ever overcome my lust for wine or my lust for tobacco or my lust for eating in between meals or overeating or whatever, eating pork chops, whatever it may be. With men, it may be possible, but with God, what does it say? All things are possible. I can do how many things through Christ? All things through Christ that strengthens us. So now, in Revelation 14, we talked about a little bit last night, is the message that we are to bear to the world. It is the bread of life for these last days. Now, how many times a day do you usually eat your daily bread?
Twice.
Two or three times,
or at least every day, right? That's even in the Lord's Prayer. Give us this day our daily bread. Well, if our daily bread is daily, and the Revelation 14 is the bread of life for these last days, it would seem to me that reading Revelation 14 every day and meditating on it and praying about it and thinking more deep about it and sort of dissecting it and understanding it upside down and inside out would be a good way to spend our time, because this is the bread of life. And it says millions of human beings are perishing in ignorance and iniquity. But many of those to whom God has committed the stores of life look upon these souls with indifference. Many forget that to them has been entrusted the bread of life for those starving for salvation. I enjoy sharing the unsearchable riches of Christ anywhere. But you know, a group like this, we've heard the Bible for some of us 30, 40, 50 years. We're the ones, you know, that meditate on the law of God day and night. But I sort of, in the last many years living out in Korea and China, where there's so many people that don't even know the law of God, let alone meditating on it day and night. They don't even know what the law of God is. And it's so refreshing. How many of you sneeze now and then? Everybody sort of sneezes. Have you ever had an experience where you feel a sneeze coming on and you're about ready to enjoy the exhilarating experience of letting that sneeze out, and it's sort of a refreshing experience, right? But you're about ready to sneeze, and then for some reason the sneeze doesn't come. Have you ever had that experience? With me, I don't know about you, but if I look at the sun, it does something to dilate or undilate my eye, and then that it brings that sneeze on. If it's almost not ready to come, if I look in the sun, it'll bring the sneeze on. But I've had a few times where I wanted to sneeze, but it just didn't come out. And that's what it's like sharing the gospel with these millions of people who are in ignorance and have never heard. It's something different about sharing the love of Christ, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. They don't even know that God had a son. And to try to share that with them is so refreshing. It's the refreshingness like you have when a big sneeze builds up and then you finally let it out, and it feels nice, right? And so if we don't have a chance, if some of you never have a chance to go yourself to China or Russia or some of these places, we can, have you ever heard someone give an offering appeal where they say, how does it go? Please, we'll have the offering plate going around, and we hope you can give an offering today. But if you can't give an offering, at least you can pray. As if prayer was less important than an offering. They ought to say it the other way around. They ought to say, brothers and sisters, please pray. Pray like Daniel 3 times a day. But if somehow you don't know how to pray, or you haven't learned how to pray, then at least you can give an offering. But they usually say it the other way around. But we need to be praying for the people in all these places around the world that have never heard, because in the last days, there's going to be a big, what do they call the musical chairs? Remember that game? And there's going to be a switch of chairs. Many of people are going to go out, and new people are going to be coming in. So it goes on here and says that in the book, Christ Object Lessons, a character formed according to the divine likeness. Now, what is the divine likeness? Christ. He's the one that said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He's the root and offspring of David, the bright and morning star. He's the one altogether lovely and the chiefest among 10,000. This character that we form is the only treasure that we can take with us from this world to the next. Now, the next world is talking about the third heaven. And so when we go to heaven, the only thing that we're going to take with us is our character and the clothes on our back and maybe our money that we have in our pocket, in our wallets. But I think at the time of the end, when we're living out in the woods and somewhere, we probably won't have money anymore. But I was trying to figure it out. Maybe Pastor Allen could help. When we're translated, you know, when we're translated up to heaven and defy gravity and start lifting up off the ground, obviously we're not going to be naked. We're gonna have our clothes, and we may have a pocket knife in our pocket, or we're gonna take some of those things besides our character. But as we somehow, when we go up through the stratosphere or ionosphere, somewhere up in there, these clothes, if we have a comb or a brush or whatever's in our pockets when we're translated, it's gonna just sort of disintegrate, and then we're gonna get the clothes of light. Isn't that how it's gonna have to work somehow?
I don't think we've been specifically told.
Okay. But when we finally get to heaven, the only thing we're going to have with us, we're going to have none of these nice electrical gadgets with us. We're not going to have our motor homes. We're not going to have our cars, motorcycles, bicycles, homes, computers, all these things. We're going to only have the character. So if that's true, doesn't it seem pretty important for us to learn now? Before the fiat goes forth, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. Before that time, to develop our character. Now, what is our character? It goes on here and tells us that if the thoughts are wrong, the feelings will be wrong. And now this is at least one definition of our character. The thoughts and the feelings combined make up the moral character. So our thoughts and feelings combined make up the moral character. Now, if you put socks on and then your shoes on, that's what's on your foot. The sock and the shoe combined make up your foot gear. Now, out in Korea a couple years ago, we had the local television people came and filmed it. It was on the evening news. It was in the wintertime, and an icicle formed in our neighbor's home. And you know how icicles, do you get icicles here in West Virginia? Okay. But in order for an icicle to form, it has to have just the proper temperature. If it's too hot, the ice will totally melt. If it's too cold, it'll totally freeze up. But when it's about 0 degrees, or no, here you use Fahrenheit here, right? Okay, around 32. 33, 32, 31, when it fluctuates between those temperatures, it'll thaw out a little bit and then freeze up and thaw out. Anyway, in Korea there, it was doing that. We function on centigrade out there, so it was zero. Anyway, this icicle turned into a pillar. It dropped all the way down to the ground, and it became a thick, wide pillar rather than, you know, the pointed shape of an icicle. And it was such an amazing sight that someone told the local TV people that came out and filmed it. But let's look in our Bibles, Hebrews chapter 4, and verse, bring your Bibles, the sword of the Spirit, the only defensive weapon in the whole armor of God, which is the Word of God. Hebrews chapter 4, we have the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness, all that, but the only defensive thing, well, I guess the shield of faith is sort of defensive too, isn't it? The sword of the Spirit, it is written. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 2. For unto us was the gospel preached, as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being what? Mixed with faith in them that heard it. So it's not just the faith, but the word. And not just the word, but the faith and the word together mixed makes that combination. Just like here it says, the thoughts and feelings combined make up the moral character. When you decide that as Christians you are not required to restrain your thoughts and feelings, you are brought under the influence of evil angels and invite their presence and their control. So, thoughts and feelings are pretty important. We can hide our thoughts and feelings. You can't very well hide a smile or some outward acts and deeds sometimes, but we can hide our thoughts and feelings, and so only us and God sort of knows sometimes what's going on in our thoughts and feelings. But out in Korea a few years ago, we had a friend come to make us a stove. He was doing welding. And him and his son were there, and somehow the son caught a little sparrow, little tiny sparrow, and the dad took a thin little string and tied it on the leg of one of the sparrows and then let it go. and the sparrow would fly as long as the string was long, and then it would be stuck, and he would draw it back in and let it fly again and draw back in. And I saw that and didn't like it too much, so had him let the poor sparrow go. But anyway, it reminded me how sometimes our thoughts can wander onto frivolous thoughts and or impure thoughts or foolishness and all kinds of thoughts the devil is going to throw at us. And but wasn't it Martin Luther, how did he say it? Something like, we can't stop the birds flying over our head, but what's the next part? You can keep them from making a nest in your head. And if a vain, foolish, selfish thought instantly flashes in our mind, we can repel it instantly and not have to be defiled by that thought. Amen. It is written, and use the shield of faith, but if we begin to cherish and cuddle and fondle this thought or feeling, then that's when it can become dangerous and have an effect on our moral character. So we do have a privilege to restrain our thoughts and feelings. And here it says, this is from, I didn't get the page, but the book, Faith I Live By. We are not to be anxious about what Christ and God think of us. This is a really nice quote, very encouraging one. We already know, yes. But about what God thinks of Christ, our substitute. What does God think of Christ? What did God say about Christ? This is my what? Beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. And if we accept Jesus, like we mentioned last night, Paul had that experience. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And here in these last days, how many of you remember that quote that says, soon there's going to be great changes in our world. And what's the next one?
Final movements will be rapid ones?
That's right. The final movements will be rapid ones. Now, I don't know what you think about that statement, but I've always understood that to mean that the final movements will be rapid ones, that when the Sunday law comes to the United States and West Virginia here, it's not going to be much longer. It'll be a rapid thing before it flops over the border into Canada and then probably down to Mexico and out to Korea and Australia. Then the death decree will come in all during this time rapidly. There'll be the tornadoes and earthquakes and more tsunamis, and the final movements will be rapid ones. But it says the final movements, and not only are movements including earthquakes and wars and Sunday laws and death decrees and international Sunday laws and national Sunday laws, but there's other kind of movements. One of the movements is, well, I don't want to be too physiological here, but we even have an expression, a bowel movement. A bowel movement can be rapid. If you eat some green apples or some unripe apples or something, it could go out the other end more rapidly than normal. But the other movement is the Great Advent movement. And the Great Advent movement is not talking about anything but God's people. And the final movements are going to be rapid in perfecting the character of God's people. There's no time left. We don't have time like Moses to go 40 years in the wilderness and learn faith and humility and self-distrust and all these other things. Time is too short. And so now is our time to cooperate with God and with angels and with Christ in perfecting a character. And the book of Daniel tells us that Daniel not only tells us about how his experiment with the with diet and appetite there in Daniel 1, but in Daniel 6, it mentions his prayer life. How many times a day did Daniel pray?
Three.
And
that we know of, morning, noon, night.
Yeah, those were the main special times, secretly alone on his knees with his hands up toward Jerusalem. And but I'm sure he sent many prayers out throughout the day, praying without ceasing. And so prayer is, in the book Great Controversy, it says that at the end of time, our only hope will be the mercy of God, and our only defense will be prayer. So now is the time to learn how to pray. One day Jesus was praying alone, and he was praying out loud. We ought to learn to pray out loud when we're alone. There's something about praying out loud that makes it more personal. Jesus was praying out loud. The disciples came up to him and they were amazed at his prayer. And they said, Lord, teach us to pray like John the Baptist taught his disciples how to pray. So we know one thing at least that John the Baptist was doing, and that was teaching his disciples how to pray. And Ellen White tells us, what is our work? Is to do the work of John the Baptist. John the Baptist prepared the way for Jesus' first coming, and all of us have the privilege of preparing for Jesus' second coming, hastening the coming of Christ. And that's when Jesus told the disciples the Lord's Prayer. Sometime later on, you can dissect the Lord's Prayer, and you'll find out that every one of those little phrases in the Lord's Prayer are directly from the Old Testament. Jesus, he lived by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God, which is only the Old Testament there. But our Father is from the Old Testament, which art in heaven. Holy and reverent is your name. Sometimes the wording is a little bit different. The psalm says, holy and reverent is thy name. Jesus said, hallowed be thy name. Same meaning. And thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. All these different phrases are directly from the Old Testament. And so in the area of perfecting our character, Daniel gives us an example of how to pray, praying in secret. Secret prayer is the most important thing. But remember, it says one place that Jesus prayed all night, went up to the mountain to pray. We don't always have to be on our knees when we pray. The book Ministry of Healing tells us when you are alone, when you're walking, when you're busy about your daily activity, cultivate the habit of talking to your Savior.
Amen.
And when we cultivate that habit of talking to our Savior when we're alone, when we're taking a walk, Enoch walked with God, Noah walked with God, put your own name in there. And then God will teach us a wonderful experience. So let's not be too anxious about what Christ and God think of us, but what God thinks of Christ, our substitute and our surety and our best friend and our Savior and Redeemer. Any questions? Out in Korea and China, we do this kind of evangelism on the street, preaching to just people that are in total darkness. So we talk about parables and health and other topics. But we have a little core group, and when I say any questions, some of our own people will ask a question to get the ball rolling. And then pretty soon other people will ask questions, and then we have a very interesting time. I want to get this song pounded into your cerebrum and pons medulli and all the different parts of the brain. I think Brother Elvis is going to be sharing about the brain. Let me see if I can get back to that. And here we go. Okay, here we go. If you will seek the Lord and be converted every day, if you will of your own spiritual choice be free and joyous in God, if with gladsome consent of heart to His gracious call you come, wearing the yoke of Christ, the yoke of obedience and service, all your murmurings will be still, all your difficulties will be removed, all the perplexing problems that now confront you will be solved. Mount a blessing 101. Okay, thank you. Yeah.